Hello, ciao a tutti. Hello everybody. Welcome to the third day of this workshop. We are, as usual, we have a very tight schedule today, and so amazing keynote presentation in the morning and in the afternoon too. So let's start with Louise Hoffman from IDPO, and have a nice day to everybody.
Okay, I think I've got it on. Thank you. So good morning. Since I didn't have an ice core scientist here with me this week to talk to you about ice core science, I'm going to do it myself. But I kind of like to do it from polar popsicles. But the real polar popsicles that we're going to talk about are going to be the ice cores and how these ice cores are gotten. A lot of you know a lot of the science, and some of you may be new to understanding it. So we're going to go through a little bit about that. But I think the original title was supposed to be Ice Core Science: Traveling Back Through Climate History to Understand the Future, which is really what the ice cores are all about. I'm the Director of Education Outreach, as I told most of you yesterday, for the Ice Drilling Program Office. And I just wanted to tell you a little bit about that program office so you kind of understand some differences about how the U.S. ice drilling is a little bit different from some other nations. Most other nations do their ice core drilling through institutions like AVI, which is the Alfred Wegener Institute in Germany, or BASS, the British Antarctic Survey in the U.K. In the U.S., NSF has established this program office to coordinate and support all of the ice drilling, including the engineering. So it's a quite a bit difference because we have hundreds of ice core scientists in the U.S. and they're spread out across many, many institutions. So this office then works on long-term and short-term planning for all of the ice core drilling. We also have a sub-award to the University of Wisconsin in Madison, and they have the ice drilling engineering and design there. So that all comes under the umbrella of the IDPO organization. So Dr. Mary Albert is the executive director of all of that. Under her leadership and work with the ice core community, we have different people who have different jobs. We have a program manager who's in Colorado. His office is at the University of New Hampshire, or at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, where my office is. But he lives in Colorado. I live in Florida. So there's great. We do most of our work remotely. I'm the, like I said, the director of education outreach, and I also do some supervision of graduate students, not their program, but really more of getting them to do education outreach. So I do a lot of work with Mary Albert's graduate students, and actually some of the other scientists that are in around Cold Regions Research and Engineering Lab that's close to Dartmouth, and also other professors on campus. Mark Twickler and Joe Sowney, I think I can, not sure where my pointer is. There. Twickler and Sowney are at the University of New Hampshire, so again, we're spread out all over the place, and it's a very tiny office when you think about the work that's done. This part, the IDDO, is the Ice Drilling and Design Office, so they have a staff there. The SAB, Science Advisory Board, again, this acronym SOUP, so Science Advisory Board and also the Technical Advisory Board, are groups that meet, and that's where the coordination comes in. So Mary Albert sets up these meetings between these boards. The Science Advisory Board is a group that meets and sets long-term plans for the U.S. ice drilling community. And they meet together, but they also talk to open up. It's a very transparent process. All the scientists give input, and then out of that comes the long-term science plan. So it was published in 2016, goes to 2026 for the ice drilling programs. And out of that, then, I mentioned there are working groups. We have the ice core science group that's interested in looking at the ice cores once they come out of the out of the ice. They're drilled out. The ice core science group studies those in lots of different ways, which we're going to talk a little bit about. And then there's a group called the borehole logging group that likes to put their logging instruments down the hole and study the hole. So we've got the ice core, we've got the hole, and then we have the subglacial access group that wants to go down the hole and get under the glaciers and take a look down there. So three different groups looking at all of the ice from different directions. The Technological Advisory Board are the ones then that take this science plan and turn it into the long-range drilling technology plan. So what drills do we need in the next 10 years to make this plan happen? Are there drills that we have that need to be updated or changed? And we have some fantastic engineers that are able to do amazing things, and even in Antarctica on the fly to come up with a new design. And just stepping out of that, talking about the science, you know, my role as the educator and talking to a room full of educators, I just want to point out that along with all of this, we do have activities online for you. In the U.S., and I'm not sure about in other countries, there's a big push now in science education to teach engineering. And most of us have never taught engineering, don't know a lot about it, and so it's kind of, they're in our standards now, and it's like, well, what do we do? So this is an activity that's called Polar Science and Engineering, and it's available to you. It's best if you can have an engineer and a scientist model it right in your classroom, but that's pretty hard to do. So we've set up a video that has a scientist and an engineer talking about a real problem that happened in Antarctica during Waste Divide, which is the West Antarctic Ice Sheet Drilling Project. The scientists drilled down. They saw an interesting area of ice that they wanted more ice. And so they went to the drillers and said, can we move the drill over and drill some more ice and get down to that and get some more? They go, sure, we can do that. How much money do you have? The scientists go, well, we can't do that. Okay. Can we drill a replicate core out of the side of the hole? And they go, sure, that's no problem. Now, you know when you're drilling that the ice sheet is moving. So as they drill, the hole tends to get curved a little. They go, no problem. We can send it down, carve it out of the downside of the hole. We can get some replicate cores. And they go, oh, no, no, no. We can't block the hole because the borehole loggers want to put their instruments down the hole. So we can't do that. So the engineer, Jay Johnson, amazing guy, says, well, you know, I think we can drill it out of the upside of the hole. But somehow we've got to engineer something that's going to grab hold and push the drill up so the gravity will still pull the borehole logger's tools down this side of the hole and we'll drill out of the top side of the hole. And he invented it and they did it. And so the very first logging and the very first replicate core was drilled. And this process of the scientists and the engineers going back and forth got us thinking that, you know, we have all these practices that are done by both scientists and engineers. What are they? And before kids can learn the difference, they need to be able to understand what those practices are. So our activity has kids listening to the video, the scientist and engineer talking about this problem back and forth, and they try to identify the practices that are being used and drill back in time through an ice core. So they're listening and checking these things off. Did one of them ask a question, define a problem? Did they develop and use a model, plan and carry out an investigation, analyze and interpret data, use mathematics and computational thinking, construct an explanation or design a solution, engage in argument using evidence, obtain, evaluate, and communicate information? So it's just a way to have them focus on the process that's happening between a scientist and an engineer and identify those practices that the two use. So we have a video of these two talking. This one was actually in a classroom. Here's a scientist, an engineer, and the student with the sheet. These are available on our website. Most of you got a brochure. It's on there. I have a few more brochures left. And then this is the type of thing that that we've identified and that our national standards have identified that science, their focus is to start with a question or an observation, and their outcome would be to come up with new knowledge. Engineers start with a problem or a need or a desire. They come up with products or solutions. You have to have both in science, and you have to be able to work back and forth. So, and then this was our first replicate core. They're pretty happy about it, so they were able to do this. It was the first time it was done. So just going to the beginning of ice cores, we know there's an ice sheet in Greenland, ice sheets in Antarctica. Dave did a great job of explaining, talking about those, or about how the Southern Ocean works with the Antarctic one. So basically, the atmosphere moves stuff all around the world, and it gets dropped in the snow in Greenland and Antarctica, and because they're so cold, they just build up layer after layer after layer after layer. So at the top, you have lots of, you have the snow, you've got a lot of pieces of the atmosphere in here, and then as each layer builds up, it's starting to push down on the layers below, so you've got this pressure starting to build up. In the fern, it's very open and porous, and that might go down 60 meters. But then there's a transition. There's so much pressure that it becomes ice, and it captures bubbles of the atmosphere in the ice, and they're preserved there for at least 800,000 years, and I think scientists are trying to get back to about 1 million years before we hit bedrock, and so they're trying to find that really old ice. So what are the things that get trapped in there that scientists can look at? And there's a lot of stuff. They're able to use volcanic ash, for example, that falls. The volcano erupts someplace in the world, gets caught in the atmosphere, and gets dropped in the snow. So they can date the ice core using volcanic footprints that are left in the snow. There's lots of things like aerosols, which are solid particles in the air. Just the accumulation of snow, they can tell from about past temperatures. Dating, working on time scales, gases like CO2, methane, trace gases. They use electrical conductivity, stable isotopes to identify temperature, and there's lots of others. So there's many, many different scientists all looking at the same ice core and then coming together and deciding the story and the history that's told there. So here's an ice core that I hope you can see the layers in it. In some ice cores, the layers are very obvious. And the lighter layers indicate summer, and the darker layers indicate winter. So you can go light, dark. Every light and dark is a year, so they can count back until there's so much pressure that they can't see those layers anymore. So that's one way that they're able to come up with a time scale for ice cores. And then, like I said, you can get a beautiful ash core layer. This was taken by one of our founding members, as a matter of fact. PEI founding member was on the first executive committee was Heidi Roop. So Heidi took this, and this is a beautiful ice core, this ash layer in the ice core. This is probably one of the most famous pictures because it's such a nice one. This is another one that one of our scientists, Mindy Neiswanger, took. This one was 21,000 years ago, 3,500 years ago. And then from that, they get all kinds of information. This is the carbon dioxide record going from present back 800,000 years. And you can see this up and down. And you see that it's constrained by about 300 parts per million. And then the low, about 180 parts per million. Over here, you've got temperature. So this is the temperature record going up and down. And these are temperature anomalies here. And then over here is the methane record in parts per billion. So it's on a little different scale, but you've got, if you look at these graphs, they look very similar. So you can see from the ice cores that we've learned a lot about temperature on the Earth through these different records, like oxygen isotopes and deuterium are some of the ways they decide that. But these graphs are so similar that they're learning a lot about how the atmosphere works and how our temperature works together. And of course, we've all seen this graph that the largest rise in greenhouse gases has occurred since the Industrial Revolution. So we're up. This is methane. This is the carbon dioxide over here. And we're up close to 400 and have hit 400 parts per million. And so you can see that this is way out of the natural cycles for at least the last 800,000 years. And the rapid increase is what is concerning scientists. So how do we get these ice cores? It's kind of a fun story. You've seen lots of pictures of Antarctica. Got the big LC-130 landing on skis out at Waste Divide Camp. Waste Divide, again, is West Antarctic Ice Sheet, and it's the divide of, this is the map of Antarctica. This square is the big square here. So Waste Divide is where the ice flows to the Ross Ice Shelf and to the Weddell Seal. So it's a seal, Weddell Sea. So it's the divide where the ice flows in different directions. And they wanted to get that ice and see what was happening on the ice shelf, ice sheet. Just a picture of that camp. It's kind of fun to see what it looks like where these people are working. Every year they have to dig out the work hut where they work. And just some pictures inside the where they're working and where they're getting the drill. The drill is real tall, goes down deep into the ice, has cutting heads on the drill that spin, and the ice goes up into the core barrel. The core barrel comes out, very long cable to get it down to the length that it has to go, the depth that has to go to get these deep ice cores. So Waste Divide is over and done, and they've published over 100 papers so far. All the ice has been sampled and looked at and studied, but they're now in the process of requesting additional samples, so we have archived pieces of ice that are kept at the National Ice Core Lab. And studies will continue for probably a decade more on that particular ice core, and there will be archived pieces for our students when they grow up and come up with a new question that needs to be answered. We don't have to go back and drill ice. We've got it archived so they can get ice. Oh, and I wanted to point out the depth, 3,400 meters, 11,000 feet. It's a really long record in time. This was an ice core project that found a distinct biological component. I thought this was interesting. These are ice crystals here and here, and this boundary area has just a little bit of water in it, and in that area, they found living bacteria. A lot of questions left about it, but they've been able to melt it and see respiration. So it's pretty amazing. It's still lots of questions to be answered about how these extremophiles live and what they do, how they make a living. So some lessons learned from Waste. Got a much better, greater high-resolution time record. So now it can be used as a standard for a reference chronology. This is important. They found that there are abrupt climate changes that can happen very quickly, and that Greenland can have an abrupt climate change, and Antarctica can follow maybe 200 years later, that there's opposing temperature changes. Another one of the projects that come under the IDPO umbrella is the Spice Core, so South Pole Ice Core. It was a long, deep ice core, about 50,000 years of climate records. They wanted to go to South Pole because it's so cold that trace gases are able to be preserved, and they're able to study the trace gases. No results yet. No papers have been published. The last ice core just came back a month or so ago. They're going to be processing it this June out at the National Ice Core Lab. So they're just beginning to get a depth age scale on it. So the big ideas from the ice cores, and I don't mean these are from the ice cores that are just IDPO ice cores, but the ice core world internationally has all worked together on finding out some big things from the ice cores. This thing that abrupt climate change, that there are tipping points that we can cross, and you can get significant changes in the climate system, and they show up in the ice cores. The evidence is there. And that this is the thing that's interesting as a scientist and concerning as a citizen, that these can happen in the order of decades, not hundreds or thousands of years, but there can be abrupt climate changes. There's also a correlation of atmospheric CO2 and temperature. We've seen that on these graphs, and those were shown from the ice cores. So this idea that one causes the other, but that they are correlated, the temperature and CO2. So when CO2 rises, it warms the planet. And so there, one of our scientists said to me, he goes, so we really don't need computer models to tell if the Earth is going to warm by us burning fossil fuels. We're doing this experiment to burn fossil fuels, put carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, but we know how that experiment's going to end because we see it in the record in the ice core. The ice core records show us how the experiment of CO2 is going to end. Rising CO2, it's going to warm the temperature. And then the big idea is during the warming at the end of the last glacial period, the warming started in the Arctic and then covered the Earth from north to south. And the current large changes in the Arctic are a special concern because of what they've seen in the ice core record of how the Earth has warmed. So just one other activity before I go. I wanted to point out that yesterday, I think it was, someone mentioned that there are places you can connect to scientists through APEX, through PolarTrack, through, you know, different organizations that will connect you, and we're hoping to get PolarMat through me. You can come to me through climateexpeditions.org. We have an activity called Checking Out Your Team, which helps you prepare your students to ask good questions of a scientist, and then I can set up a webinar into your classroom with a scientist who will come virtually into your classroom and talk to your students. They can ask questions back and forth, and it has worked really well. I've done that in several different places now, and we have lots of scientists that are more than happy to do that. So, you know, we work a little ahead of time to make sure the technology works. We work together to get your students some background information so they ask good questions. And so it's a nice activity. So, thank you. I don't know if anybody has any questions. Jenny?
I have one, but I'm not sure if this is for you or perhaps Laura, and so maybe I should wait. But you mentioned that they now know there's living bacteria in the ice cores. And don't bacteria breathe carbon dioxide or methane? And are we sure that's not affecting the climate records that we're seeing from the ice cores?
I asked that exact question, as a matter of fact, to one of the scientists that was studying it. And she said there may be some, you know, how much is, they don't know. And so it is a question that they're looking at. They're not sure how many there even are. I mean, it's like, you know, they're still at the beginning of trying to understand it all. And I don't know if there's been other studies. I've only talked to this one scientist. But it seemed to me that when I was asking questions of her, that there are more questions than answers at this point. So and that's from me, who's not a scientist. But that, I had asked the same question. Yeah.
Another question?
Oh, whoops.
Not really a question, just a very short story. The oldest Icelandic glacier ice is about 1,000 years old. And it has been forecasted with high certainty that the Icelandic glaciers will disappear in 200 years. So we are losing this ice 5 years every year. Yeah. If we don't rescue it, we cannot preserve the glaciers. We might be able to preserve some ice cores, and we need a place somewhere that gathers the ice cores from all over the world, because they are going to disappear, most of the glaciers. And then this history that they contain will be lost.
Yeah.
Rescue to be started.
And that is definitely an issue. And one of the things that from our office that we're trying to do is make ice core drilling more agile. And I went, when they used that word with me as I was new on that, I'm going, agile, the drill twist or something? But no, it's more portable so that they can get places easier, because these ice cores, Spice Drill and Waste Divide, are giant drills. The logistics of it is crazy. So we've got lots of small drills and lots of smaller drilling groups going out all over the Arctic and the Antarctic and doing it. And I know other nations are too, and realizing that that's exactly right. It's a, we are on kind of a time schedule here that we've got to get things done. Yes, ma'am.
Just going back to Jenny's question, if there is lots of carbon in the ice core, then that's where the source of carbon dioxide would be. And that's the concern for permafrost thawing, where there's lots of organic material. And, you know, it could be that that was where a huge amount of carbon dioxide or even methane could be released.
Yeah.
So.
Absolutely.
What a run. Actually, it's a reply to Audio's comments from before about trying to save some ice cores. There's a French project, or French-led project, called Ice Memory, and they are currently moving out ice cores all over the world to try to like keep them for the future, for future analysis. I know they're traveling. They just received some ice cores in Bolivia, where they will be storing some, and I know like it's... So ice cores from everywhere being stored in other places. I think they have a web page and a Facebook page. It's called Ice Memory.
And also one ice core from the Ortles Mountain that is right there here in Italy will be given to this project to be preserved for years. Any other questions? Thank you, Luis.
Thank you very much.
Quello che si sente?
Yes, yes, it works. Allora mettiamolo qua.
Okay, let me introduce the next speaker. Eva Pisano from University of Genova, ISMAR CNR of Genova. Sì, non capisco perché. Ah, sì, ok.
Sei brava. Sì, ok. Allora, vado con questo o con questo?
Guarda, questo qui andrebbe bene.
Posso mettermi
sì,
qua?
Sì, mettetelo lì.
Yes, thank you very much. Good morning. First of all, I would like to thank very much the organizer for giving us, to me and Marino Vacchi, that will present to you the next topic, to give us the opportunity to speak about fish. Fish are the favorite subject of our personal research. Marino Vacchi is most involved in ecology and fisheries and conservation, and my subject is more related to evolution and adaptation of Antarctic and Arctic fish. This is an outline of this lecture. First of all, I would like to show you which kind of fish are the Antarctic fish, a general overview, very simple overview of these animals. I would like to show it to you how the story of Antarctic fish is an history of change, and I will show you some major adaptive trait features of these animals in terms of biological adaptation, and then I will finish with some more general on fish as player of educational tools. Not yes, we ah. Okay, sorry. So first of all, where the Antarctic fish live. They live in a stretch of ocean that surrounds the Antarctica, the continent. This is a very big region that you know, of course, very well, and is surrounded and separated in some way to the other oceans by a current, a circumpolar current, that in some way isolated this coastal region of the Antarctic Sea. And as you know well, this stretch of ocean, the Antarctic marine region, is changed very much during the year, and because in winter, most of the time, the Antarctic Sea, the coastal region, is covered by ice. And only for a few months, there are some places of this region that are free of ice. And this Antarctic region, this Antarctic Sea is very different from the other polar sea that is in the north, in the Arctic, because of course, of the presence of the big land, the continent, and this makes the two regions similar in some way in terms of, for instance, in temperature of the water, but very, very different in terms of ichthyofauna, fauna living in the sea around Antarctica. The fish living in Antarctica, in the sea of Antarctica, are very, very different from fish living in the North Pole. And which are these fish? When we speak about Antarctic fish, we speak about a special group of fish named Nototenoidei. In taxonomy, they are a suborder, They are bone fish, only bone fish. And they are present in Antarctica as the most abundant ichthyofauna, representative of the ichthyofauna. So in Antarctica we have the most, Notothenioidae are the most diversified group in terms of biodiversity, and also the most abundant in terms of biomass. Actually, if we compare this group, Notothenioidae, with other fish that live in the same region, in the Antarctic region, as you can see here, the number speaks very clear. Notothenioidae represent most half of the diversity of fish in terms of number of species, and represent more than 94% of the abundance in terms of biomass. So we have a lot of fish in Antarctica. And because of this big amount of biomass, although the species are not very numerous, Notothenioidae and Antarctic fish are very, very important component of all the communities, and then they contribute very much to the marine biodiversity in Antarctica. And they live everywhere, and they are all, some species are very important component of a special community in the Antarctic Sea, that is the cryopelagic community, that is the community of organisms living near the ice, the sea ice, of course. I speak only about sea ice. And then, of course, Antarctic fish, for the fact that are very abundant, are important component of the food web in Antarctica, where they occupy the medium level, and also sometimes for some species the top level. I mean that most of the fish are small fish, and they are consumer at the medium level of the trophic chain, but some fish, as you can see at right of this picture, can be big and are really top predator in the food web. And among these top predator, there is this fish, the Antarctic toothfish, that is one of the targeted species for fishing in Antarctica, because some species are living resources for the humanity, for feeding the humanity, and they are target of commercial fishing. But about this part, fishing, conservation problems, Marino Vacchi will speak next to me soon. So I would like to show you now that how the story of Antarctic fish is strictly a story of change, big changes. Actually, the Antarctic fish are really the survivors of a long story of change that is related to the changes occurred to the continent, to the Antarctic continent. And their story is related to the modification of the Antarctic during its fragmentation from the supercontinent Gondwana. Until the continent reached its position, its present position. During this long time, the oceanography of the seas surrounding Antarctica changed very much, and many, many species of fish died. Only Antarctic fish had some chance to survive. Among the big changes during this story, related to the geology of the Antarctic continent, of course, the temperature was the most important parameters. And in this slide, you can see the drop, the big drop of temperature in the last 65 years. We start from a value that is more or less 20 degrees of in the water temperature to the minus 2 degrees that are more or less the temperature that we found now at present in the coastal region of Antarctica. During this time, we have not record of a lot of fish that were present. We still don't know from which group of fish the Antarctic fish are originated. So we have some information, but we are not very sure. But probably the Antarctic fish arise from a benthic group, a group of fish that lived near the bottom. And very slowly, some group, some species, we have information about some species, and in the last 25 years, a lot of species exploded in the coastal region of the Antarctica. And we think this was helped due in some way to the particular condition of the sea ice near the continent in this period, because at that time there was the formation of the circumantarctic current that followed the opening of the Drake Passage, and this makes the temperature of the water stable and cold, and is isolated the region. And this helped the diversification of various species. But ecological situation was not sufficient to help these fish, Notochaenoidae, to diversify, because a biological event was really very important to help this diversification. And actually, a key event in the radiation of this group of fish was the formation, the biological arisen of some molecules that are antifreeze, the antifreeze molecules, that are present in all the species that we found today in the coastal Antarctic. Probably you know how this molecule work or not, so I say something about these small molecules. First of all, they are very small proteins. And these small molecules link to the ice crystal, and this lower the possibility to the ice crystal to grow. And at the same time, this process lowers the temperature of the body of the fish below the value of the temperature of the seawater. So below, they froze below minus 2 degrees instead of other values. So in this way, by means of antifreeze molecules, the fish can live in a place where the ice is very present and is abundant. So they can feed also small particles of ice, but the ice crystal doesn't grow, and the fish doesn't freeze. In addition, I can stress that only notochaenoids in Antarctica possess antifreeze glycoproteins. And this means that during their occupation of the environment, they had not competitors. So the combination of absence of competitors and presence of cold adaptation by means of the proteins helped the Antarctic fish to diversify and occupy all the available place in the coastal region of Antarctica. And if you look at the distribution of these species now in Antarctica, we found species that live near the bottom, in the water column, near the ice, everywhere, because there was no competition with other group of fish. Of course, during this long story that I made very short, fish changed from their ancestors. So during their adaptation to the new condition of the environment, they changed very, very much from their ancestors. In which way? I use some example, because actually there are many, many different kind of adaptive modification in these fish. For instance, I saw before that probably this fish derive from a benthic group, a fish that lived near the bottom. But most of these fish have acquired the capability to live in the water column. And they are devoid of swim bladder, because they originate from a benthic fish that doesn't need this kind. You know what is a swim bladder? A swim bladder is an organ that allows fish to move in the water, to go up and down. And all the Antarctic fish have not this kind of organ, because their ancestors haven't. But they live in the pelagic habitat thanks to a suite of modification of their skeleton. The skeleton of some fish, Antarctic fish, is very light, and lot of fish have a lot of lipid that help buoyancy in the water column. And this was a big change, from a biological big change. One of the species that is very much modified in respect to their ancestors is this small fish, the Antarctic silverfish, that has a life cycle very strange in comparison with the other Antarctic fish. And probably you know that this fish, recently we found a nursery for this fish, and Marino discovered that this fish developed within the ice, within the ice the cover. And from the eggs that you see in the top of this slide, the embryo developed and gave rise to a lot of fish, the small Antarctic silverfish that populate the ocean. And this is one of the species the most abundant in Antarctica, and has completely changed from its ancestors that were benthic, related to the bottom. Other fish are very strange. For instance, the so-called ice fish are very white in color, and they have lost the capability to synthesize hemoglobin, and they don't possess red cell in their blood. So they have the blood completely white. In this tube test, you can compare the color of the red color of normal blood in fish that have the red blood, and the white color of this kind of fish. This was actually a mistake, a biological mistake. These fish have lost one capability, but they survived in this environment because hemoglobin has the role to bind to oxygen and to bring oxygen around the body. But in Antarctica there is a lot of oxygen, and they can live without putting oxygen in their red blood. They can live without hemoglobin because they are in a very special environment where oxygen is very, very abundant. So, in some way we can say that Antarctic fish are the biological experiments, and I can say also that they can be considered in some way biological responses to change, to environmental change. These changes, of course, occurred very slowly during the time, long, long million years. In any case, they, at present, they are important models to study, in some way, the flexibility of biological system facing changes, environmental changes, climate change more in general. So in most of the studies of this fish are concentrated to understand the mechanism of change of fish to evaluate our flexibility to change in the future. And to finish this this small lecture, I will say something about educational. We are scientists, we are not educators, but we know how it is important to try to find, to connect scientific world with the educator world. And since we know, in general, that fish, in general, are very popular to all of people, and they can be very, very effective in communication to non, from specialists to non-specialist people. And I found this in the internet that I found very, very nice, and you can see how is the message from this protest is very direct, very clear. They are members of Swiss Trade to protest again the financial sharks. So the message we get is very, very simple, very direct. If you consider Antarctic fish or polar fish in general, and if we consider the ecosystem in which they are part, we can stress that fish, most of the fish in Arctic and in Antarctic, are consumer at the medium level, and at the same time they act also as a predator of the lower levels in the food chains. This peculiar dual role makes the fish ideal in educational tools, because they can illustrate, we can use fish to illustrate very simply how the system works, and we can explain better the interaction between different level in the food chains, and we can explain possibly in an easy way how the system will change if something occurs to the fish. And for this, having in mind this kind of context, I and Marino, we tried to provide some tools to the educators using fish. And that is why we published the first book for children that is called Il Pesciolino Argentato, Viaggio alla scoperta del mare dell'Antartide, that is here for people that want to give a look. And this is the story of two small fish. You can follow the story of one fish from this side, and then we can turn and follow the story of the other fish on the other side. And this really is a true story, because it's the story of the Antarctic silverfish. So we can find the small eggs, the young embryo that develops, and the young fish that go around in the Antarctic Sea to explore the system. And so here we have the small eggs, where the small fish are contained. And in springtime, in November, the eggs open, and the small fish start their journey in the Antarctic Sea. There are two fish, a lady and a boy. So this lady, the girl, that is quite interesting, because there is not a stereotype of the lady, but the lady is very similar to the boy in its interest to explore the world. And they meet all the other inhabitants of the sea, so the big fish, the toothfish, and the other inhabitants of this fantastic world. The second book that is very recent is this, and I have there will be some copies that Matteo will use as he likes during this meeting. And this is different. It's a book for adults or young, not very small, and are illustrated tables showing the different environment where fish live. And this is, for instance, the cryopelagic community, the ice. So you can imagine to dive from the ice, in a trough in the ice, and look under the ice. And these are silverfish, Antarctic silverfish, and the small eggs near, very close to the sea ice. And if you go to dive deeper, you reach the bottom, and you can find these fantastic colors that are true, because the drawing are made from video cameras looking on under the ice. And you can meet also this big fish, the Antarctic toothfish. That is the fish that is fished, and it lives very deep in the Antarctic water. So I finished, and I leave some time for the questions.
Any question? Okay. Maria Pia first.
Thank you. It's not scientific question, simply I was admiring the illustrations. Who did the illustrations? Chi ha fatto le illustrazioni?
Ah, yes. The illustrations are made by a professional person that usually illustrate book of mushrooms. But it was very available to us because he likes the polar world, and he did this without money. And we went to the Antarctica, but he was not there. So we used a robot to look and to take picture under the sea ice.
Yeah, we know that, because yesterday we had people from
yes,
the same
group
of Genova.
Yes, yes, it was the same group of Genova that make robots and And we use this kind of system to get information on the communities, and the drawer uses this kind of information.
So as we work with audiences and students teaching biodiversity and specifically in these communities, we are always looking for resources of photographs and the adaptations that fish. Yeah. So similar to the two that you showed, the one that no longer uses hemoglobin. Do you have a library of such photographs with adaptations of fish?
I have more than this. I have a video. I can give to... I have a video that I show you because I have here, but I don't show in... it's long, but I will... eccolo qua. There is this this tool, I mean. The name is Life in the Frozen Ocean, and we did this during one expedition. And in this video, the focus is Antarctic fish and adaptation that they have. So what I can do is to provide... I have not a lot of copy of this now because it's quite old. but I can give to Matteo to put YouTube, I don't know, or to make copy of this. Mm-hmm. If you are interested, we can also try to find the time to see the video in this meeting. I don't know, I ask. I leave to us, okay. And you can... what you like.
Okay. So it's possible to publish online.
Yes, because it's my responsibility, Marino's responsibility. I agree.
No, because also we are looking for materials put in our website, Polar Educator International.
Yes,
so
I'm very happy because it's made to help.
Thank you very much.
And if you have questions also related to the video or also to the book, you have my email. Without problem, yes.
And I have a question about... Yeah. I'm interested in the methods used to understand, for example, why a species 30 million years ago, scientists can understand that didn't have the protein, and why scientists can understand that after 20 million years they have the protein.
Yes.
So what are the methods?
The methods are very simple and complicated at the same time. I mean, the Nototenioidae, the Antarctic fish that I was the object of, are a very special group of fish because their story start very early when there were not antifreeze protein, for instance, and then they had... other species formed during the time, and now we have three groups that are related to the non-Antarctic region. So we have some Nototenioid fish species that lives in Tasmania, in South America, and they have not the cold adapted feature, but they are part of the same group. They are strictly related to the other. And so we can compare the fish that have adapted and that live now near the Antarctic land with their relatives that are that remain at the other side, in South America, in Tasmania, in Australia. And we can compare their structure, their DNA, their sequence, their morphological feature, their physiology, and we can understand which mechanism changed, because they are the same group of fish, and we have each species, each group represent a step in the modification. So it's quite complicated, but the Nototenioidae are very related to each other, very close very close group, but some representative are not cold adapted and live in other place that yes. in the Southern Ocean, but not very close to the Antarctica. So by comparing everything, cells, DNA, physiology of the different species, we can understand which changed, which system
and
changed.
So do you use also fossils for the evolution of this fish or not? Because we don't have.
No, unfortunately, we have not fossils. We have only one fossil that helped to put a date for the origin of some. So we need fossils, of course. We had one, and we used this to put a date in the history.
And where this fossil was found?
In the Antarctic Peninsula.
Okay.
In a small region where there is no ice,
yeah,
because
yeah,
the problem is that there is ice.
We have information about the situation of the fish life.
The fish?
The fish life in the sea, in the Vostok Lake or Concordia Lake, that is 3,700 deep under Antarctica.
You are, I don't know if you, this is a question or is...
It's a question. How is the, how are our information about the fish life there now?
I don't lakes, think
the
it's
deep
I don't think this is a good source of information. Maybe I can share with Marino this this problem. My personal opinion is it's not true.
No, we have another question. Oh, you have
no,
a question?
Aspetta, vuole rispondere a questo.
No, at Vostok Lake and other lake in the ice cap, there are no indication about the presence of fish. But in some lake that are found in area in the ice barrier, not so far from the sea, there are presence of fish, no? And it's possible to consider the fact that this lake, almost for a part of the year, are completely separated from the sea. And so that is very important to consider this mechanism, biological mechanism, for the survival of this fish.
another question?
For education, have you ever set some presentation or books that compares fish in polar regions to fish in other regions like Mediterranean? So we could compare this to different environments with our students to be easier, because when you speak about Antarctic flora and environment, it doesn't help if you don't make a comparison with our environment. I speak from, I teach in Italy, so I speak about Mediterranean. So my question is, have you got some material that we can use to compare these two kind of different environment?
So this is really a question, important, because... because there are not many books of Antarctic fish, first. If you try to find, you don't have a book. There are some scientific books, but there are. I remember when we decided to start, there was nothing. So this is the first point. And the other point is that there are not still book in which we can compare easily the major groups living in temperate regions and polar regions. There, in my, I don't know about that. It's not very easy because you must be specialist, because we are specialists of Antarctic fish. Maybe Marino is also specialist of some group of Mediterranean fish. But it's difficult to find somebody that starts to do that. It's possible, but we have to start. I'm sorry, we have, I don't know about this kind of facility. Especially in simple way. You can take the big volume of Mediterranean fish and try to compare. It's very difficult, very difficult.
Questo me lo metto in tasca. Il puntatore è questo. In questo spazio qui. E per andare avanti.
Il puntatore è questo qui. Andare avanti qui. Sì. Qui c'è il puntatore, questo qui.
Perfetto, benissimo, benissimo, perfetto.
E questo è per andare avanti.
E questo è per andare
indietro.
Indietro.
Per tornare indietro. Sì, sì. Avanti. Aspetta che.
Sì.
And now the last speaker for this first part of the morning, Marino Vacchi of University of Genova and from the Institute of Marine Science, CNR of Genova too. Okay, so Marino.
Thank you, Vanessa. Good morning, everyone. I am an associate researcher of the Institute of Marine Science of the National Research Council. I have also another activity that is related to the activity in the commission of the protection of marine living reserves in Antarctica. So my speech is related mainly on this part. Is supported by the previous speech made by Eva Pisano about the characteristic of Antarctic organism. So the title is indicative about the purpose of my speech, that is the recent initiative to protect in effective manner the Southern Ocean and the Antarctic organism. Just in short, the Southern Ocean is here represented. The waters that surround the Antarctica is more or less 10% is also called Austral Ocean or Southern Ocean, and is more or less the 10% of the oceanic surface. Is well separated from other seawater in temperate region by, in particular, the South Antarctic Polar Front, that is an area between 50 and 60 degrees south, where is clear the decrease of seawater temperature in superficial level, because the temperature of seawater pass from 5.5 degree centigrade Celsius to 2.8 degree centigrade in just 50 kilometers from north to south. Is a true oceanographic barrier that well separate the Southern Ocean to south to the other temperate water. So in this ocean, the flora and fauna is very, very particular. Thousands of endemic species that come from bacteria to whales are evolved and specialized and adapted in this unique closed and frigid environment. For people that are interested to have an update publication about the life in Antarctica, I indicate the recent publication made by SCAR, that is the biogeographic atlas of the Southern Ocean, where all forms of life are considered. The story of Antarctic organism is characterized by also by exploitation, human exploitation. The first exploitation that was carried out in Antarctica started from mammals. In particular, the first one were the fur seals. Fur seals that in subantarctic islands, like South Georgia in particular, were exploited and considered of interest from the original information obtained in Cook diary expedition data. Millions of fur seals of the genus Arctocephalus were utilized in particular for fur. The fur seal hat was in the past, in that period, a sort of a status symbol for rich people. And just in 40 years from the start of exploitation from the ant, almost all the fur seal colonies in South Georgia Islands were completely destroyed, severely depleted, and the ant was abandoned. The other organism utilized in exploitation in historic area of Antarctica was big seals, like elephant seals, that was used to have oil for lamp around the world, and it was a similar experience for the fur seals. Exploitation of seals was abandoned, but in 70 years there was an important agreement between countries that established this convention for the conservation of Antarctic seals. Another species that was considered in historic era was whales. Whales in subantarctic islands, South Georgia in particular, from different countries, were utilized to have oil, also for lamps or other question or other aspects of utilization. The first step to protect whales was made after the Second War. with the creation of an international whaling commission. In 60 years, with the protection of the very big whales, like blue whale and humpback whale, in 1986, there was in Southern Ocean a moratoria about the hunt of whales, and from 1994, there are the presence of a whale sanctuary in the Southern Ocean. The last one organism considered for exploitation in Antarctic seas were fish and also krill, the small shrimp-like crustacean that is the food of whales and other top predators in Antarctica. Activity exploitation of on fish start from 70 years when oceanic fleet, fishing fleet coming from different countries start to fish in subantarctic area with very important result in terms of biomass gathered. Okay. So, but on fish in particular, the indication about the state of of the stocks create very high concerns because in just three fishing season, for example, this species, Nototenia rossi, considered the target of the fishing activity, was depleted at 10% of the virgin stock size. So, and the same was for the first attempt to exploit krill. This situation created a big debate in side the Antarctic Treaty Organization that established a particular commission as a branch of Antarctic Treaty that is CAMELAR, CAMELAR Convention of the Conservation of Antarctic Marine Living Resources, that came into force in 1982 and CAMELAR was involved in the rational use of living, marine living reserves and the protection of the ecosystem. This is the area of the CAMELAR Convention that more or less coincide with the geographic boundary of the Antarctic of the Antarctic polar front or the Antarctic convergence between 50 and 60 degrees south. CAMELAR at the present was represented by the presence of 25 countries member and other acceding states that work with CAMELAR. Every year there are annual meeting to decide the future of marine living reserves in Antarctica. Every decision is based on the general consensus of all country members. So very difficult aspect that prevents strong negotiation between the different countries. So the first decision by Kamelar in the 80 years were related to the block of some particular destructive fishing activity. For example, the fishing exploitation on the Nototenia Rossii, that in the area where there are the historical exploitation is only monitored in terms to detect the recover of the stock. Until more or less 30 years of no fishing in this area, only now there are some indication about the recover of the stock. So this indicates the particular vulnerability of the fish stocks in Antarctica, that in relation to the particular life cycle have a very long period of renewal and recover. At the present, there are in particular an activity of fish, a deep fish that live in around Antarctica. So are two different species, very similar, that arrive almost 2 meters in length and are very appreciated in a commercial sense. This activity is managed by a precautionary approach, and the quota that fishing vessel have as indication in the fishing activity are very precautionary. The fish is the so-called toothfish, two species. One is the Patagonian toothfish that live in subantarctic waters. The other one, very, very similar, is the Antarctic toothfish that live in the more strict Antarctic waters. All these two species are marketed with the commercial name of Chilean sea bass. Chilean sea bass is not Chilean, but is a commercial name. And the market in particular, where Chilean sea bass arrive, are the US and Far East market. Kamelar collect information about the report from commercial activity, but also from research and the report from scientific observers that by law are present on the fishing vessel operating in Antarctica. So, more or less, until recent years, Kamelar was organized as a general fishing commission, like, for example, NAFO, ICES, and ICAT, etc. One of the more important results from Kamelar activity was, for example, the fight under the illegal fishing activity, the illegal, unregulated, and unreported fishing activities by the different system, scientific observer on board, but also satellite system to follow the activity in the Southern Ocean area. Another important result was to eliminate almost completely the accidental mortality on seabirds like petrels and albatross by a particular system to avoid that seabirds are attracted from the fishing systems. So Camelar, until recent years, that worked as a fisheries commission, the protection of Antarctica remained until recent year a business of Antarctic Treaty System that create only small area protected in Antarctica. Some interstellar zone, other in marine coastal waters, some other areas with in both in terrestrial and coastal water. 75 of the actually protected area, ASPAS, were established in Antarctica, considering in particular some aspect about the presence of penguin colonies, for example, or presence of particular flora and fauna. One of ASPA was created recently by an initiative jointly organized by Italy and the USA in an area close to the Italian station in Antarctica, Mario Zucchelli Station, where in this area there is the presence of one of the more important colony of emperor penguins in the Ross Sea, and also in this area was discovered the particular reproduction of a silverfish, of Antarctic silverfish, under the ice. In particular, as Eva told, this fish use the sea ice coverage, a particular part of sea ice coverage, the so-called platelet ice, to as a spawning and nursery area for the reproduction. In to summarize the Camelar activity, the already objective indicated by the mission of Camelar in the past, targeting in particular aspect of fishery, in the recent year, there was also an activity by Camelar about the protection of ecosystem, in particular the establishment of a representative network of marine protected area in the Southern Ocean. Camelar launched this activity following the general agreement, the more important are the Johannesburg World Summit on Sustainable Development and the Convention of Biological Diversity, that indicated the necessity to create an effective system of a marine protected area around the oceans to, with the objective to have until 2020 10% of the oceanic surface protected. At the moment, we are only at 2% of the world's marine water with some degree of protection. What is the main threat in the Antarctic Ocean? First of all, overfishing, so fishing not regulated or fishing fishing activities that are not conducted with a precautionary approach. The other one is the climate change. Climate change that in Antarctica are very evident in is very evident in particular in the Antarctic Peninsula, where the mean air temperature in the last 50 years is increasing of 3 degrees, and this change in the environment is indicated by the collapse of very large coastal glacier, like for example, like for example, this system of coastal glacier in the eastern part of Antarctic Peninsula that is called Larsen Glacier. Three different parts of the glacier, the Larsen Glacier system, are collapsed in some cases very rapidly. In 3-4 days, there was the complete destruction of the glacier. In general term, the climate change is an aspect very important to consider about the fish fauna, because in Antarctic Peninsula, some fish species cold adapted that in the past was present in massive biomass, like Antarctic silverfish, in Antarctic Peninsula area are now more rare, and there are the presence more abundant of species that normally live at the border of the Antarctic convergence, like for example lanternfish, that have more or less the same habitat and ecological niche of Antarctic silverfish. So CAMELAR start this very hard path of in the creation of Antarctic marine protected area by a strong effort in terms of bioregionalization of the different sector of Antarctica, considering all the different part of biological communities. The first positive initiative was the creation, the establishment of the South Orkney Islands Marine Protected Area that is focused on the Antarctic Krill. It's an area not very large in terms of surface. It's only 97,000 square kilometers. That is not so. Is not so large respect to the area of the Southern Ocean. Anyway, in 2009, all country members agreed the establishment of this small marine protected area. But in general terms, from bioregionalization, the discussion in the annual meeting of CAMRA was focused in particular to the creation of the NEFET network of Antarctic marine protected area. The four principal of these are the Ross Sea region marine protected area, the East marine protected, East Antarctica marine protected area, the Weddell Sea marine protected area, and the Antarctic Peninsula marine protected area. All these proposals were strongly debated during the last annual meetings, but last year, in 2016, finally, the proposal of Ross Sea region marine protected area was agreed from all CAMELAR member. The path of discussion was very long, 5 years of strong negotiation in terms of define the boundary of this area, but the establishment of this important area is a milestone in the activity of CAMELAR and also for the humanity. Some indication about the Ross Sea region marine protected area are that 72% of the this marine protected area is a no-take zone, so no fishing is permitted in 72% of the area, mainly the continental shelf of the Ross Sea, but also some part of the slope, the continental slope, the deep grounds. In two area indicated at with SRZ, Special Research Zone, and KRZ, Krill Research Zone, fishing activity is permitted only for scientific purpose, to improve the knowledge about some aspect of in the biological life cycle of Antarctic toothfish, special research zone. Possibly, special research zone is the connection between continental shelf of the Ross Sea and deeper grounds in the Southern Ocean for these species. And the other krill research zone is an area completely unknown in terms of the consistence of the krill stocks, and so the importance for foraging top predator that live on the that feed on these species. Okay. This area is 1.5 million square kilometers, the Ross Sea region, marine protected area. Some aspects are particular. 35 years is the duration of this marine protected area. Is not indefinite. There is the necessity to create until the next month an effective research and monitoring plan to manage this marine protected area. In the workshop that will be in at the end of April in Rome, there are strong discussion about the creation of this research and monitoring plan between the CAMELAR countries. I finish. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Marino. So there are any questions?
Who provide physically the legacy or these protection areas against illegal fishery and other illegal situation? Who physically boats or police, I don't know.
Italy, Italy is not involved in commercial fishing activities in Antarctica, but have a strong cooperation with people, with countries that that carry out important surveys on the fishing reserves. In particular, we have a strong relationship with New Zealand. And recently, Italian scientists participate on board fishing vessel during winter in the area of convergence in a survey focused on the reproduction of Antarctic toothfish. And for the first time, this group of scientists, New Zealand and Italian, discovered for the first time eggs of Antarctic toothfish and describe this very important part of the life cycle of Antarctic toothfish.
If I'm not wrong, you were the scientist. Okay. So I think that we have to start our, just a second, the coffee break. We are starting again the second part of the session at 11:30. Please go to visit the exhibitor area at the end of this hallway. And there are the tickets of the lottery that you can buy to the students. So remember that tonight at the dinner we are having the lottery, the extraction of the numbers. So please. No.
c'è.
Hello, please have a seat, please come. Please come. I know that Italian coffee might be very dangerous for the break and invite people to have a longer break, but we have to start our session. Please have a seat.
Pronto?
Io inizierei, sai, Alessia. Alessia, io inizierei.
Ma solo che tante volte si sperata.
Please have a seat.
Okay.
No.
I'm going to present the next group.
Have a seat, please, that we are starting the second part of the morning. And
Next talk is scientific drilling of polar oceans, opportunity for scientists and students and educators, and is presented by a group of three scientists, De Santis, Olivo, Massolino, and I'm very pleased to introduce them today because they belong to an institution that was among the first that really understand the potential of cooperation, innovative ways of collaboration between scientists and teachers. Welcome.
Thank you, Matteo. Just a few words to explain you why we are three persons in one single talk. But we are, all of us work in Trieste at OGS. I'm a senior scientist. I'm a geologist as a background. And I use geophysical data, especially collected in Antarctica since many years. And Elisabetta Olivo is a PhD student. She's working on geophysical data collected in Antarctica. She will tell you something about her personal experience. And Giulia Massolino is also a PhD student. Giulia, sorry, I introduce her. This is Giulia, and this is Betta. They're both very nice and very motivated, brilliant PhD students, and they are helping me in carry on lots of activities, and Giulia especially is involved in outreach and education. So just to tell you what our talk will be about, As I said, I'm a geophysicist and geologist. I worked a lot in the field of polar drilling, scientific drilling in polar areas, and I'm the next Rossi expedition, the IODP expedition in Antarctica in 2018. I'm a co-chief scientist together with Rob Mackay from University of Victoria in New Zealand. And I'm also the co-chief officer of PAIS, the SCAR geoscience program, dealing with past Antarctic climate dynamics. And so I'll be organizing the conference in Trieste in September, and Julia will speak about this later a bit. And that's why I'm talking to you about this topic, so scientific drilling and polar ocean. And then Elisabetta will talk about the OGX Explorer 2017 Antarctic cruise in the frame of the Italian Antarctic program. This cruise was instrumental for collecting site survey data for the IODP expedition of next year. And Julia will speak about the outreach and science communication at OGS, also in the frame of the PAIS conference that will be held in September. I think you can have a seat. Much more comfortable for you and me as well. Sedute. Okay, when you speak about scientific drilling, most of the case you speak about IODP, the International Ocean Discovery Program, which is the largest geological program of the world, has been drilling all oceans since 1968, so next year will be the 50-year birthday of IODP. It's founded by many nations in the world, but is managed mainly by U.S., Japan, and Europe. They have different roles. So U.S. mainly managing the JOIDES Resolution vessel, which is drilling all ocean down to 1,000 meters below the seabed in a water depth of up to 5,000 meters. And then the Japan is managing the Chikyu. Is a larger vessel drilling much deeper in the crust. And then the Europe is managing the mission-specific platforms, employing different tools, different vessels, also platforms all over the world. And the choice of the platform depends on the target. So in this case, they are not using always the same vessel, but they're selecting, they hiring the vessel depending on the targets. That's the figure showing how many nations are involved in IODP. Many nations, including US, Europe, the ECORD Consortium, European Consortium for Ocean Drilling, which is also includes Canada, and then ANZIC, Australia and New Zealand, Japan, and then China, India. The budget is about $200 million of US dollar. And depending on the fee that each nation paid, there are berths available on board, but everybody can also participate as a shore-based participant. Those are the vessels that are used. Again, those are some pictures. That's the JOIDES Resolution. That's the Chikyu. And those are examples of mission-specific platforms run by Europe. In this case, in 2004, the mission-specific platform was for drilling the Arctic Ocean. That was the first scientific drilling in the Arctic Ocean. And they haven't done anything like that later on, but there is another expedition which is planned for 2018, the fall of 2018, in the Arctic as well. And the call for application will be open at EGU this year, in a few days. The ocean drilling program has been very, very important from a scientific point of view. Many interesting, important milestones were achieved. This is just one of the examples. The drilling of the seafloor the ocean seafloor allow to actually test the hypothesis of the plate tectonics, because basically the rocks on the two sides of the ocean ridge were drilled, and so it was proven that they have the same age on the two sides of the ocean ridge. So that means that volcanic rock are erupted and deployed on the two sides of the ocean ridge symmetrically, and this is a kind of a pushing mechanism of the two plates away from the ocean ridge, the mid-ocean ridge. Another important scientific results obtained by ODP is the proof of the Milankovitch theory, proving that the actual climate is changing. We do have glacial-interglacial cycles, and they are linked to orbital forcing and different age scale. And this is proven by the age and the type, the chemistry of the fossils that were sampled by ODP. That's a figure showing the huge amount of holes that have been drilled in 50 years by ODP all over the world. I just put some emphasis on the Italian participation. Italy is very active on this project, but also other nations as well. And I just wanted to point out that Italy was also leading the leg 178 in 1998. 20 years ago in the Antarctic Peninsula, that was an important leg. For the first time, not only the continental shelf near the ice sheet was drilled, but also the slope and the rise. So it was the first time that it was possible to link the ocean dynamic to the Antarctic ice sheet evolution. And we are repeating the same thing in the Ross Sea next year, 2018. Again, I'll be co-chief of the Ross Sea leg, which is here, with the GIDES. So 20 years later, we are back to Antarctica and trying to catch some more secrets from the Antarctic margin. The core repository is huge. It's spread all over the world again. There is some cores archived in Europe, in Germany, at the University of Bremen. Some of them are in the USA, at Texas A&M in College Station, and some are in Japan, at Kochi University. There are really a large amount of cores still available. Anybody can ask for samples and use them. So the ODP is as a scientific prospectus, as a plan. Basically, not only past climate is one of the main scientific targets, but also we have deep earth processes and impact. We are also studying volcanic arcs, magmatic processes, subduction zone. This is particularly true for Chikyu, for the Japan vessel, which is drilling very deep. And of course, we are interested in process and hazards and all sort of scientific targets. This is a figure showing what's the potential for teachers and educators to be involved in this scientific project. There are several opportunities. This is the website, so take a note of the website address. They also have a Facebook and Twitter. They are in the social networks. And you can navigate in the website. You will find all sort of information. Basically, the teachers can apply to sail. And we have an example here. Alessia was one of those. Just recently, she's back from Expedition 367. She has a poster, and she's here. So if you want to ask her personal experience, she'll be happy to answer. And there are two things that can be done. You can apply to actually work as an outreach person, so interact with the scientist. You have to suggest, you have to submit a proposal. You need to tell what you want to do. It could be a blog, it could be a photograph product or all sort of things. But you can also learn. There is also the School of Rock, so you can learn what's the scientific target of the expedition. And so there are two different kind of different kind of call that will be open as soon as the expedition is defined, is confirmed. Then the IODP will open calls to all community scientists and educators. So you will find this information in the website. So who can apply? Classroom teachers, informal science educators, artists, videographers, writers, social media experts. So if you have ideas, just send your application in. And the contact person for IODP is Nicole Kurtz. She's the one that provided me also a PDF presentation, which I give it to you so you can spread. The last example in the Arctic Ocean in the leg of 2004 was there were two educators, one was from Sweden and the other one is German, I think. And those are the link with their reports and photo galleries. And the next call will be for 377 in the Arctic Ocean, and that will be open by the end of April 2017. So keep an eye out to the website. As Marino Vacchi also pointed out before, it's very hard to build ice shelf and continental ice on the continent and in surrounding the Antarctic ice sheet. It's very easy to disintegrate, so it happens in a few days or a few years, like in this case. And we really need to understand what's going on, what's the processes, and we can do it by investigating the marine areas around the Antarctic continent, especially close to the grounding zone where the ice is attached to the bedrock. And especially true for the polar regions that are affected by the global warming more than the low latitude region, as is pointed out also by the IPCC, which is showing nicely that in the future, if the global climate will warm in the low latitude, it will warm even more in the polar areas, and that will affect, of course, the melting of the continental ice. So there is a large SCAR geoscience program, as I said, as I told you, which is PAIS, that is particularly focusing on this issue, which is to understand the impact of this atmospheric and ocean temperature rising to the Antarctic ice sheet. We want to understand what's the melting of the ice, what's the meaning of the melting of the ice to the global sea level rise. And also we want to evaluate the contribution of Antarctica to far-field sea level estimates. Basically, we want to test the vulnerability, the sensitivity of the Antarctic ice sheet to the global warming and sea level rise. So what PAIS does, PAIS is particularly focused on drilling the continental shelf very close to the grounding zone, very close to the point where the ice sheet meets the ocean, and trying to understand what's going on today from reading the sediments, so for learning the lesson from the past climate archives, which are in the sediments. So we are drilling very close to the ice sheet, and also in the distant area close to the edge of the continental shelf where the ice sheet was once extended. And also we are drilling the continental slope and the rise to actually link the Antarctic ice sheet, the ocean, the Southern Ocean, with the rest of the planet. This is a little cartoon showing basically what we are drilling. We are drilling very close to the Transantarctic Mountains. In the case of the Ross Sea, we are about here. We already got these records from the Andrill and Cape Robert projects in the past. So now we are completing the story by drilling the mid-shelf, in this place here, and the outer shelf and the slope. Basically, we want to reconstruct the whole story of the ice, the advance and retreat of the ice sheet, and how the warming of the ocean actually act to contribute to trigger this kind of dynamics, advance and retreat. How we do it, again, we do it by drilling. So Andril was drilling the place closest to the grounding zone. In this case, it's very hard to reach this place with a vessel because most of the case, the floating ice shelf are preventing the vessel to come closer. So we use this kind of tool, which is a platform installed on the floating ice, drilling through the water column down to the seabed. And to actually drill the outer portion of the continental shelf, we use the JOIDES resolution. So we have a bunch of coordinated projects from 2018 to 2019, 2020. We have a coordinated action drilling all this portion of the Antarctic margin in the next three, 4 years. And there is a huge amount of money involved and coordinated again by this SCARPA-IS program. This is an example of how we actually select the place that we want to drill. Of course, we are not drilling anywhere because it's a lot of money, and so we have to carefully select the sites we want to drill. Where we have to optimize the maximum thickness and the best potential dating material. And how we do it? We do it by collecting geophysical data, which is actually showing us very nicely the rocks, the sediments below the seabed, by using acoustic tools. Beta will show you some images of the recent cruise. This is a portion of the Ross Sea we are going to drill next year. So what we are looking at is this kind of faces here, which is a sort of a delta. I don't know if you can see it. These oblique inclined reflectors are due to the advance of the ice. Once the ice was advancing up to this point, and it was delivering sediments at the front, like a bulldozer pushing sediments and going on top of it, sort of preparing its platform to advance more. And this is what we are looking at because there are footprints of past ice sheet advance. So we want to drill them and date them to understand when the ice was there and when it disappeared and why from the sediments. So we are looking at this information from moraines, glacial moraines, that are now left over near the shelf edge. They also, some of this material has been falling down along the slope by gravity flows. And the current also used reused these suspended sediments and reorganized along the continental margin in sediment mounds. Okay, I think that's it from my side. So I pass to Betta. She'll talk about our cruise. And if you have questions, we probably can answer later after the three of us, okay?
No, non funziona? Sì? Funziona? Sì. Ok. Ok. Hi, I'm Elisabetta Olivo. Yesterday a student asked me, how did you get here? Okay, I start with a bachelor degree and a master degree in geology. And then I start with the bachelor thesis near here in Bozen, in Boldano, studying the rock fall. So from woods and fields, I arrive in Antarctica. And now I'm doing the PhD in polar science with the University of Siena, but my work is based in OGS in Trieste. And only to say, but maybe there are not PhD students here or student at all, but I only want to say that if there are teacher here, you can say to student that PhD program is a great opportunity to do summer school and courses everywhere in the world, in Europe. In my experience, I did a great courses and summer school, and especially the ECOR summer school last year in Bremen. And for me, is a great opportunity to know different kind of scientists and students and technicians, and also for get involved with the IODP world. Laura told before about the IODP, how to get involved with IODP for teacher. I only want to add that also for students, you can apply for an expedition. So I know that from ECOR Summer School, so it's a great opportunity, as I said. And, okay, now I'm talking about the last expedition with the OGS Explorer. We returned 1 month ago from Antarctica, from Ross Sea. We spent two entire months in the sea without no one day touching land. So this was our great group, and we start from Hobart in Tasmania, and we return in New Zealand after 2 months. And this was our trip. We circumnavigated all the Ross Sea, as you can see. This is our path. We get through all the Ross Sea because we had five different projects to carry out. So. One was during the transfer between the New Zealand and the Ross Sea, and the other four were in the Ross Sea. Three of them, like me, were in the, on the slope because my PhD thesis is on the slope. So I had the great opportunity to help to collect some data that I will use for my thesis. And the other great thing was that we collect lots of different kind of data. So we were geologists and geophysicists and oceanographer on board. So we collect multi-beam data, seismic data, oceanographic data. And another thing was that, great thing was that we were an international team. So from Italy, Croatia, Spain, France, Korea, China, and this is also another great opportunity for me, for a student, but also for a scientist to share information with other people from other countries. Great. And only to show you one of the, I think, thousands of images that I collect in 2 months. And as you can see, seems like a great day with sunny, warm day. But in this case, we needed to stop all the operation because we were not stuck, but quite stuck between ice. So an Antarctic cruise, it's not every day great, but okay, was a great day for photo. So. And another problem that we had on board, that it was that we didn't have internet or we have only a few meg of internet a week, but we used that mega for send a blog to our local journal, and after Julia can tell you something about this. And only to say that last thing, we didn't have on board teachers or educators because our ship is tiny and we didn't have place for them. But I think it would be, I don't know, maybe in another cruise or something like this would be a great opportunity to have educators on board also on Explora. So now I can leave Julia to talk about the blog.
Yeah, that's where I come into onto the stage, because they asked me to help with the outreach, especially on the web promotion, let's say, of the expedition. And yeah, they didn't have any educator on board, but we exploited them a lot. So we gave them a lot of extra work for the outreach part. So they were really busy also on this side. And the OGS decided to open the Facebook page, as of course probably shouldn't be done, so in a hurry, and when the ship was already departing. And so we have not many followers right now. We are learning by doing, let's say. So if you want to follow our Facebook page, we sometimes also write English things in English, even if the most of the things are for an Italian audience. And also because the Facebook page was related to the blog that, of course, was of the local newspaper and so had a local audience. And this was one of the first posts. And actually, the very first post was a video interview to Elisabetta. So you can find it, and it has also English subtitles. So I interview her before leaving, and how does it feel to go to Antarctica for the first time. And this is one of the last posts in which we finally got 4,000 people of reach. That is quite a lot for us, that consider that we have only 400 followers on the webpage. So it was a good challenge. And this was an Italian, so a national newspaper article, web article, and in which they interviewed Florence Colleoni, for those who might know her. And our Facebook page is not just a promotion of our activities, but of course also all the things that are related to the campaign. But yeah, the funny things that I have nothing to do with Antarctica or anything like that, because I'm a structure engineer, and so why I'm here, maybe asked. And yeah, the reason why I was asked to help with the promotion was that I have a master in science communication at the International School for Advanced Study in Trieste, which actually I do suggest for I don't know, educator of any kind, or both for scientists or educators, because it's a very nice opportunity, I think. And after the master, you have a very strange idea, such as buying 360 cameras that we send to the Antarctic expedition, because it looks a little bit like science fiction, but it could be a great opportunity to take people on board with you, because it's a very nice experience. I don't know if somebody of you experienced the Oculus 360. It's a very nice thing, I think, and very immersive. And in theory, it would be really nice to have also the Oculus Rift, but we think we will buy the good cardboards because it's a little bit difficult. But that was just to say that after the video will be, of course, edited. They just came back from Antarctica, so we need a little time. For that, we think we will finish the edit in September. And next year will be probably available on YouTube with a 360 application. And so if you have your student can also see them, usually students have a much better smartphone than I do, so they will probably be able to see it, all of them. And I think that, yeah, a Google Cardboard is something that probably a school can afford to buy. And it's a nice experience, I think, to engage with young people also with the new technologies. And so the follow-up is that Laura asked me to help with a video collage in that will be shown in a theater in Trieste during the PAIS conference. She will talk about the PAIS conference for just a bite in a while. And yeah, the very nice thing is that the video will be shown in the theater, but mute, and with a live orchestra playing under it, so it will be a great experience. And it will be, of course, only for the participant of the conference at first time, but we are planning to propose it also for a science communication festival, which is called Trieste Next, and which took place in Trieste in September, I guess, also in September, so. And that this year will be the topic will be the sea, so it's perfect. and both at this Trieste Next and at the PAIS conference, we are planning to launch our 360 movie, so to give the opportunity to researchers and after to a wider audience to test this technology. Yeah, that's it.
Just a couple words again about this conference. This is organized by myself and Team Nash with the help of the former PAIS leaders, Carlotta Scuzzi and Rob De Conto, and the help of Anna Walling, who is an oceanographer, and Valerie Masson, who is the head of the IPCC Working Group 1 and the IPCC office. Well, can you hear me? So the themes, the scientific themes that will be discussed during the conference are listed here, and they are about past Antarctic ice sheet dynamics, but also people from the biology world will be very much welcome to attend because of bioregionalization and all this DNA history helping us to understand how climates evolved in the past and how the environment adapted. And what I wanted to say is that we will have lots of rooms that we are not going to use so much during the conference, because the idea is to have everybody in the same room for plenary, oral presentations and posters, but we have to rent the whole building. The whole building has a big plenary room, a big room, and few other smaller rooms that can be used for other initiatives. So if you have ideas, you can come to contact us, or Julia, or I mean, Apex also is very welcome to help. And we can organize something for you. And we pay already for the rooms, so no extra cost. Just your travel and your work will be very welcome. Thank you. It's shaking because the vessel is moving a lot.
There will be a problem with the
going
up. Are there any questions? Yeah.
No question. So thank you very much. And before we leave for the lunch, there is our president, Patricia.
Just the final words. This is maybe the last opportunity here, we all together. So I would like to ask you, please go to PEI website and register as a member, because it's very important for our organization. Please don't be only a member in the Facebook page, but go to our website and register as a member, because we need that data for our organization grow up and try to find funding and some other things like that. And if you want to become a little bit more active in PEI and help us to leave this send this organization forward, please take another step and apply for our council as a council member. We sent out the solicitation in the next week, and you can find it in the website, in the Facebook page, and in the Twitter. Okay? So we are waiting for you. And thank you all for being here and exchange your ideas and thoughts and knowledge.
And the very last communication. This afternoon you will find the banner that we decide to personalize for this PI workshop. So you will find this banner at the school. Please sign up the banner. Sorry? Ah, oh, okay. So we also will have maybe a notebook that we are bringing in every workshop. So please write your comments or just a thoughts, whatever you want, and it's just for future memory. It's very old-fashioned way to history, yeah, to make a memory. Thank you very much. So have a great lunch. Lunch is in the same place. So today we don't have the leading group, the person that lead the group, but you should be able to find the place. And at school, it's at 2 p.m., if I'm not wrong. 2 p.m. at school? Yes. We are starting at the school at 2 p.m. So. Oh, yes.
Reiner, would you come up here, please?